Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Richest Men in Town podcast. I'm Mike Freeman, and along with my good friend and co-host Tyler Gould, we're excited to welcome you to our little podcast project. Tyler and I are just a couple of middle-aged husbands and dads driven to live our best lives. We want to be better every day, so here we'll be sitting down with great people. Not famous people, but great people that we admire. To learn their secret to living the rich life. Probably not the rich life you're thinking of. Our guests come in humbled and surprised at the invitation and hopefully leave feeling proud and grateful, realizing just how good they really have it. So pull up a chair, stay a while, and raise a glass with us as we toast our guests to the richest men in town.
All right, Tyler Gould, long time ago, we are in episode 92, but a long time ago, back in episode 49, we were talking about Sister Sonia Sopapillas with Joe Elkins.
That's right. I remember that vividly.
Absolutely. And from Joe comes tonight's guest, Beth Harding Young. What stands out to you as you think about the time we just spent with Beth?
I mean, Beth is a ball of energy, man. Like, she's got so much energy. I love it. You know, she talks a lot about, she's very passionate about her family, right? And the growth that she sees in her family and the growth that she sees in others. But one of the things I love that Beth talked about tonight was just this idea of having holy habits and creating spaces for you to grow your testimony, to grow your spiritual relationships, given all of kind of the madness of life, you know? And I thought that was, I love that, you know, that's a lesson we all could take into.
Yeah. And I think that she's energy. That's right. She's passionate about a lot of things, right? Health, nutrition. I mean, she recently lets us in. I mean, she's coming out of a recent car accident that was a pretty scary thing that's got her maybe even learning some things. But what I love about our time with Beth is she's learning from life.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
She's learning from these adversities. She's learning from some of these things that she's going through. She's learning from her kids. Right. And what I dig about our time together is it all fell in context of that plan, right? Heavenly Father's plan for us and how we go through these things. And as we go through these and have these experiences, we're putting them in the context of what that plan looks like, what truth is, and how we can stay true to it.
Right. You know, she talks a lot about those difficulties in life. And one of the things that she said was, Heavenly Father loves us no matter what. Right. And you know, it's such a simple line,
right?
Yeah. It's so simple and it's basic, but it's so deep at the same time. Right. And when you listen to what Beth has experienced in her life and then hear that statement said from her, it's really powerful.
Oh, and she gets into scripture study and what that life looks like and what prayer life looks like. And I mean, there's some practical things that people can look at and be like, oh, that's interesting. Recognizing the hand of God the day before, right? Yeah. In your morning routine. And as you train your eye, you see it. Oh, that's interesting. Praying to know who needs my help. And even if that, when that impression comes, stop the prayer.
Yeah.
Grab your phone.
Go. Yeah. You know, look, it was a ton of fun tonight. She's super knowledgeable in a lot of different areas, and she's got her, you know, she's got her passions, like you mentioned, health and you know, I think that not only are you going to enjoy the time that we have tonight with Beth, but we're going to be able to connect you with Beth through some of her channels too. I think it's going to be a blessing for a lot of people.
Yeah. And I think that there's more Beth Young coming on the show too. I mean, I think we just got started with her, and that's 2 hours warning.
Yeah.
The podcast is 2 hours long.
Yeah. Right?
That's nothing new. But with Beth, you get into these situations where it's like, wow, there's a lot of things you just dropped, and I would love to go there, get back in here so we can continue to have the conversation. So loved it. To Joe Elkins, thank you so much, right? To all of our guests, to even listeners, if you know of folks and they're all around us that are living rich lives, man, drop us a line, Facebook, Instagram, let us know, and we will hunt people down. We'll hunt people down and we'll get them on the show, and we'll continue to learn. So Tyler, thank you for what you brought tonight. To Beth, thanks for the way she showed up. To her family, thanks for loaning her to us for a couple of hours. And we're so appreciative. So to our listeners, thanks for your continued support. Enjoy episode 92 with Beth Harding Young on The Richest Men in Town.
Ricky and I went out to this little taco shop and down by the bay and had some live music going on. And
yeah, rule number one, man. No, rule number one, no pictures.
And they were playing.
Right? If I'm missing out and you're taking pictures.
And the guy was singing, "I Got Friends in Low Places." And I thought, man, this is Mike. This is right up Mike's alley, man.
Oh, I would have grabbed it. So is that the Royal Rooster?
The Royal Rooster, man. It is.
Shout out to the Royal Rooster. This episode is brought to you by the Royal Rooster.
Yeah, Royal Rooster
is legendary.
Legit, man. Yeah, it's for real.
All right.
The real deal, man. We'll hit it up. We'll hit it up.
All right. Well, let me tell you about my the evolution of Mike Freeman.
Yeah, let me hear it.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah, yeah.
Right? I am doing things.
Yeah.
That I've never done before.
Okay, I love that.
Check this out.
Okay.
My wife has a secret pal, right? Oh, and my wife's secret pal,
okay,
is like big fan of maple bars and Diet Coke. And so I get out of the Y the other morning and I'm going to help my wife out. I'm going to go buy her secret pal a maple bar.
I feel like there's something behind this. I need to know what's going on with the secret pal thing.
The secret pal thing will work.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Clarification.
Sorry. I thought that was universal and understood. No, that could mean other things in other circles.
It could mean other things. I mean, yeah, I don't know.
And all by right. golly, I would not buy that guy a maple bar. This is a secret sister pal okay. from work who
all right, so you hooked who up likes with
maple a good bar. Maple bar. Who doesn't like a good maple bar? Right?
I'm not a maple bar fan, but
you're
go
not
ahead.
A maple. You're not a maple fan.
No, I'm not a maple fan.
The
no.
smell, right?
Yeah, it's horrible. Yeah, it's awful.
Well, anyways, so I go to my favorite donut shop. Mm-hmm. Right after I get out of the Y, I go to the donut shop. I go through the drive-thru and they know my order. Two old fashions, large chocolate milk. You know what I'm saying?
Wow. I love that.
I order a maple bar
mm.
and they're like, okay, what else you want? Just maple bar. And they're like,
whoa,
what's going on? I go to the donut store that I frequent and I don't get me anything.
Man.
Right? So hold on. That's the donut store. And okay. then I'm going to throw a bonus in there. I remember Kelly saying that her secret pal, man, hopefully she's not a listener. Otherwise, the secret's out.
Well, you know, maybe she has multiple secret pals.
Yeah, right.
You know?
So I knew her secret pal liked Diet Coke, right? So I'm going to swing by 7-Eleven, another danger zone for me.
Wow.
And I go in on a mission into the lion's den with all kinds of amazing... Like Gavin Spencer's going to disown me when he hears this, right? I just go in, get a Diet Coke, make my purchase, get back in the car, get home. Put the maple bar, put the Diet Coke in the car. I proceed wow. to have my Raisin Bran.
Raisin Bran? Did you really have Raisin Bran?
Yeah.
Wow.
Here's the formula.
Yeah.
Raisin Bran's getting me through the day. So I'm just not eating, right?
Yeah, I'm in the same.
Raisin Bran's kind of filling me up.
Yeah.
It's burning, you know, I can burn it all day. So I
like it.
I not only went to a donut place, didn't get donuts, went to a 7-Eleven place, didn't get junk food. Guess what I had for dinner tonight, Tyler Green?
What'd you have?
Cauliflower stir fry.
How was it? I like cauliflower.
Terrible. It's terrible.
I had chickpea pasta with zucchini.
I've become a big fan of zucchini.
I'm a big fan of zucchini.
Kelly does this, like I'm a cucumber fan, and I feel like sometimes if I step out on my cucumbers and I start eating zucchini, like I'm not being faithful to cucumbers, right? Because they kind of look the same and it's like So but Kelly's doing this thing where I'm having squash and zucchini. Me.
I like
squash.
It. Things are, hey, look, results, right? It's all about the results, man.
So I come in totally, I'm looking for some praise, right? Because I need praise.
Yeah.
I need praise. I need results. I come in, tell Kelly what I just did, looking for praise. She looks at me, you know what she says?
What'd she say?
23 years of marriage. She looks at me and says, "It looks like you're finally growing up."
You know, this is one of the many reasons I
don't grow up. It's a trap.
That's good stuff, man. I love it. I love it.
It's something.
I am intrigued by the Raisin brand, though. I do feel like Kelly's statement is valid simply by the simple fact that you're eating Raisin Bran. I mean, I don't eat cereal all that often, but the other day I had Cocoa Pebbles. You know what I mean? Like that, if I'm eating cereal, that's what it's going to be.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. It is still a Trix Cocoa Puffs. But lately, the scale has liked the combination of Raisin Bran, don't eat anything all day, and then have dinner.
Yeah, that's a good.
I'm usually anti-raisins. I think it's a speed bump, right? It's impediments. Hmm. It's you know, but I'm a Raisin Bran crunch, not a regular Raisin Bran. Need some crunch.
Yeah. All right. I like it. Well, this is good. I'm glad we got to the bottom of that.
You know what I did last night?
What'd you do?
So I had a rough day at work, right? So I text Kelly halfway through the day, it's going south. And so I text her, I'm like, "You down for some emotional eating tonight?"
All right. I love that. Yeah.
Right. Trying to sabotage the whole dang thing.
Yeah.
She takes the bait, I think. At least I'm thinking she takes the bait, right? So we go to the post office.
Like the mail bar. A letter or the bar?
The bar.
Okay.
In downtown Reading, there's a bar called the post office. We hear they have amazing food. So we get there. We sit at the bar. They hand out the menus. And I'm like, oh, man, I see three or four things that I can just tear up right now.
Yeah.
And Kelly's like, me too. What about this pastrami pesto sandwich? And I'm like, I'm all about pastrami. You don't really do pastrami. What's going on? And she's like, well, what if we split it?
Oh, the old split trap. Yeah.
You split do that?
No, see, the split trap's tough because if you decline, then you're kind of setting the tone for the evening.
You're sabotaging.
Yeah, you're sabotaging.
You're a saboteur.
But if you accept and you give even the slightest hint that you would have liked something else, it's going to go south either way. It's really a trap.
Yeah. It's a trap. it's a trap. Yeah. But here's the thing that saved it, right? Because I'm like, oh, man, I don't do that. Like the old Mike Freeman's like, you always say no to the split. Always say no to the split. And you push back hard. Be like, no, I'm doing what I'm going to do. And sometimes I'll double up, right? Not only will I not split, I'm going to get two things, right? Let's go. So she proposes the split. And I said, okay, can I get a cup of chili? Okay. Not a bowl of chili.
Okay.
So I get half a sandwich and a cup of chili and two of her onion rings. Perfect. Okay. Perfect combo.
That's not bad. You know,
I'm going to go 4.5 stars post office downtown. Oh,
wow. We've been frequenting a place called Urban Plates. We have a split combo there. We split a salad and a sandwich. That's what we do there.
Okay.
So, and it works. So
these are life hacks, people. Life hacks.
That's right, man.
For free. Right.
Yeah, you don't have to pay for this.
You don't have to pay,
a dime for this, man. Crazy.
All right, let's talk. We got Beth Harding Young, who's anxiously chomping at the bit to get on here. Beth is coming to us from Mr. Elkins.
Yeah, if for those of you that have listened to the show for a little while, JC Elkins or Joe Elkins joined us. I don't even know what episode that was. Seems like yesterday, but it's probably 50 episodes ago.
We'll get the intern on it for sure.
but Joe, you know, we asked some of our guests who they thought would be good candidates.
Well, you know what this was in the town, I put out a golden ticket.
Yeah. And if I remember,
got a golden ticket. Here's my dream guest list. Who's yours?
And boom. Joe gave us quite a few, as if I recall.
Yeah. And here we are about ready to talk to Beth Young.
Yeah, so I'm excited about this. Beth's got some energy, man, and I.
What a pre-show call, right?
Yeah, I'm ready for. I'm ready to jump in the car and hold on for dear life, man. You know.
How about we do this then? Let's get this party started.
Let's do it.
I'm wondering if Beth has any life hacks. You know,
she's got a list of them, man.
I bet you she's got a life hack or two. Beth, welcome to the Richest Men in Town. How are you?
I am awesome. How are y'all doing?
Fantastic.
We're better now that you're here with us. You're gonna increase the quality of our program immediately.
Yeah.
I'm afraid to ask what y'all were talking about before now.
We're talking about growing up.
Ah, I haven't done that yet.
We're slow at it as well over here, but Mike is eating Raisin Bran, and I told Mike, I said, if you eat Raisin Bran, that is a sign of growing up right there.
Yeah, that's actually gonna have to give up my Richest Men in Town card to Wes Franks, because he's like, Raisin Bran, man, that's about the Fruity Pebbles.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, no, so I was just sharing, Beth, I was just sharing my progression and my evolution as I'm trying to grow up a little bit and exercise some self-control. I realized that I've gone through about 46 years of doing what I want, buying what I want.
That's a good run, man. That's a good run.
Eating what I want. And now I'm starting to exercise some self-control. And it kind of feels like the Grinch when he realizes he has a heart. Right. And that little thing starts beating and you start feeling all this pain. That's kind of where I'm at right now. It's like, whoa, this self-control thing is really pretty amazing. Right. I went to a donut place to do a favor for my wife and didn't get myself a donut.
Look at you.
Yeah.
I went into my weakness would be 7-Eleven again to do a favor. Didn't buy me anything. Excellent. Last night we split a meal, Beth.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Did you have a fever or something? Did I feel the earth shake?
Yeah.
Tonight, I had cauliflower stir fry.
Ooh, yum.
And really, cauliflower is the gateway, because now pretty soon I'm going to be eating cauliflower pizza. You know?
Yeah. 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 That's what I eat. I've been gluten-free, refined sugar-free, and dairy-free for about 8 years.
Wow. What?
Never too late. But it got rid of my migraines and my arthritic symptoms.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Hold on. Back up. Gluten-free, sugar, refined sugar-free.
And dairy free. Because we're not cows. We don't have multiple stomachs. We don't weigh in over several thousand pounds. And what animal in nature continues to give their child milk when they can chew? So it's not good for our bodies. It's just
Tyler,
not.
did you plant, Beth, here? Because you did
dairy free?
I did a dairy free stint.
I am a dairy free. I was dairy free for a while. I'm not 100% free now, but I don't consume it all that much. Once it was gone, it was easy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Much easier now.
Yeah.
Yeah. We had one of our sons had asthma really bad as a kid, and always have gunky nose and everything. And I asked the doctor, is there anything we should eliminate or add for him? No. And he just had all kinds of issues. And when he was 19, I went to a holistic doctor and he said, he shouldn't be on dairy. We got him off dairy. He didn't have asthma flares anymore, and it helped his insomnia.
Oh, wow.
And so, think of it, you know, when your kid has a cold, you don't give them dairy because it gets it all gunkier, you know?
Yeah.
So it's a technical term, gunkier.
Yeah. I like that. Yeah. I like that term, gunkier. Yeah. I understood it completely.
Now, I'm not
that's fantastic.
Yeah. Gluten-free is not for everyone. I'm sensitive to gluten. I don't have celiacs or anything, but it will give me headaches. But if you don't have a physical response to it, as long as you're eating whole grains, it's all good.
Yeah.
But,
this episode is off of. This episode is not brought to you by the National Dairy Council, then.
Right? <No. laughs> But eat the red meat. Just don't drink the milk. You can eat the cow. Just don't drink his milk, right?
Well,
her milk.
So right. Beth, I don't know. Tyler is full of life hacks, right? He's teaching me some hacks on playing the guitar. He's teaching me, you know, we talked about the splitting of the meals as a life hack. Beth, in your experience, what is your go-to best life hack that you would share with somebody to live a better life?
This is an interesting and challenging one.
Off the script, right? Off the script. We give you a script, and then the first thing we do is like, boop.
Well, think about how, as Christians, we try and put the needs of others before us. You know, do unto others as you'd have done unto you, and all those other things. Love your neighbor as yourself. But we forget the as yourself. And so if we don't love ourselves first, we have an empty vessel. And many times, and I was guilty of it, you know, PTA president, Young Women's president, I mean, all these things at once, thinking I have to help all these souls, you know, and I wasn't helping myself. And so I was not honoring who I was. And I really was not honoring what I think God wants us to do. And so I think we need to put ourselves first when it comes to mental and physical care, because then we have the ability to care for others. And I finally got that. But it took a brain tumor and a variety of other things to finally say, stop, you don't have to help everyone. And I had have a dear friend that is a marriage and family counselor. And she's like, Beth, you have done a great job in figuring out how to be mindful and take care of yourself. And when stress is hit, you have different things you go to help you do that. And that's great. But it's really good too, if you let other people figure that out rather than just always rescue them. And I'm like, what? Right? Like, now it doesn't figure mean we shouldn't
out. Figure we that still out need to versus serve. Rescue them.
Yeah.
Because the best teacher is natural consequences, right? And we want all our kids to get into their trouble before they're 21 and could end up in jail, because then the natural consequences, they can learn from it, yeah, but not have a criminal record the rest of their life, you know. So
what's the balance there, Beth? I mean, how do you look at someone and say, okay, I'm going to help this person and not help this person at the same time?
Well, I think it's really important to listen to your heart and listen to the Spirit. You have to start the day saying, okay, Father, I know you're going to put people in my path today that are, I need to help, or they need to help me, that I need to listen to. I may need a smack in the head and it's going to come from someone in my path. And so then I think it's a little easier, but it's tricky because I am like an over-the-top nurturer, which another name for that is enabler. You know, there's a real fine line between the two of them. And having grown up in alcoholic homes and dealt with lots of addicts in my family, I'm just really good at enabling. And I learned, thanks to our youngest son, when he was a messed up addict, that I had to not nurture the way I was used to nurturing. And tough love is not tough on them, it's tough on the parent. Yeah. But when I finally got it when my husband said, because I'd go over to my son's car and leave food in it because I didn't want him to starve. And he's like, so you don't have a problem paying for our son's drugs? I'm like, what the heck did you just say to me?
I'm like,
I'm not paying for his drugs. He says, well, because he doesn't have to buy food, now he can buy more drugs. Mm. I'm like, I suck, you know, but I learned.
Yeah.
If we'll just learn, then it's not wasted heartache, right?
Well, I'm thinking of a coworker right now who from time to time will get kind of caught up on family and where people are at. And, you know, their child has struggled with homelessness and addiction and all those things that come with it. Right. And it's like, oh my goodness. Like, you know where that kid is right now. How can you not run and go get that kid and get him under your roof? And they're like, look, let me tell you some stories.
Yeah. There's a lot of stories that go with it. When our son finally got clean, we told him he could only move back into the house if he changed out his phone number and didn't have any contact with people he'd interacted with before that were addicts. And he's like, I can do all of that, but my best friend Johnny from high school that he would do casual drugs with, but Johnny wasn't an addict, so he could do it, you know? And we're like, then you can't live here. You have 3 days to figure out where you're going to live. And thankfully he was in recovery. And so he opted not to go to meth heads couches and places where he had lots of connections. So he got his Boy Scout tent. And he went out into the woods, because there's lots of woods in Texas, and set up his tent between our house and, you know, like a couple miles away and where his work was. And though I just cried, because I thought some homeless person is going to murder my son for his tent in the woods. But 3 days later, he says, Mom, can I come talk to you and Dad? I'm like, always. You want to come to dinner? It's like, yeah. And he's like, I'm ready to give up Johnny.
Mm.
And you know, and that was hard. I thought it was going to be a long time, but you know, it's amazing what a little humidity and bugs will do. And
chiggers.
Shower and
you got chiggers, you know, in Texas.
Oh my gosh. Yes.
No,
but we've got no cm gnats here in just off the lake where I live here in Utah. They are worse.
Really? Worse.
But anyway.
Well, that's interesting. I was just having this conversation with my daughter tonight. We were talking about, you know, just helping people in general. And, you know, I made the comment to her that, you know, you can't dive into the water to save the people that are drowning and let them all climb on your back. Right. That's a recipe for disaster. So there's definitely a balance there. Right. I mean, and the other part of that too, is I think that in order to help, we've got to have our foundation secured.
If you can't swim, don't jump in the water.
Yeah, right? That's right.
I'm thinking of every first aid CPR training you've ever had, right? When you come up on a situation, you gotta look around. You gotta look at the situation and make sure that as you enter into this situation, you're not putting yourself in harm's way.
And sometimes you don't realize it till you're in the water, and you have to be willing to say, "Gosh, I can't do that."
Yeah.
And that's hard. That's hard once you're in the rescue mode.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But that is a great life hack. We do have another question that we sometimes throw out to guests right as they jump in. And this will be interesting, Tyler, because we have been asking as of late, what is one thing a man should be able to do? And so I'm going to ask if we're compiling a list, what is one thing that a man should be able to do?
Notice when things are out of order in the house and take care of it rather than expect someone else to do it or be asked to do it.
So what does out of order mean? Like something's not functioning or like the pillows are not where
like the dishes could be put away, okay, or there's shoes cluttering on the floor, or dinner's partially cooked and for some reason whoever started it had to go rescue someone. Just be willing to be observant, be outside of yourself, and be aware of what would make a calmer, peaceful place.
And step in and take care of that.
Yeah, and just do it. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's probably better than riding a horse, Mike. I mean, you said riding a horse. I think.
You know what the second one is, though? What? Learn how to clean a stinking toilet. That's not the wife's job. Just saying.
That's true. That is my job in this household.
Good for you. My husband had never cleaned a toilet except on his mission until I was on bed rest with being pregnant with twins.
Wow.
And he came out with the toilet brush and the toilet cleaner's like, "Tell me what to do." Like, you're kidding me, right?
I think I took 2 years off from cleaning a toilet while I was on my mission. I don't think that
ever I'll tell you, I did not like to be going into an elder's apartment. You know, when they change things out, I'm like, oh my gosh, we need a day to like disinfect and destroy.
Yeah, that's a bad scene. Yeah.
So Beth, where did you serve?
I served in North Carolina.
North Carolina.
The Charlotte Mission. That's where I first fell in love with Southerners. So moving to Texas later was just a joy because I love that Southern hospitality. It is so real, so real. And that's part of who I am. I mean, I talk up strangers all the time. I chat up with them all the time. And my family's like, "Could you please, you know, be quiet?" But when we first moved to Texas, we were in corporate housing for like a month and our dog, who had never done this, went pee on the carpet in the apartment we're in. And I'm like, I don't know how to get, because it, you know, it's the urine smells. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm in the carpet cleaning aisle and I'm looking at different things. And this lady just says, "Are you looking for a good carpet cleaner?" I says, "Yeah. You know, my dog peed on this carpet." She says, "I've got the best stuff. Give me your phone number and I'll tell you how to come to my house and I'll give it to you." I'm like, who are you? Yeah. I mean, and that's just normal. People just go out of their way to help. It's just really cool. I love that.
That is awesome.
So I loved being in North Carolina.
Well, okay. So you've given us, you actually, as we were talking, you've dropped a couple of things that I hope Tyler has made note of, because we're definitely going to be coming back and bringing these things. But can we talk, because you and I have been in contact trying to make this happen. And we were talking back in November. Can we get can you give us a little bit of a highlight, low light? What happened in November and how are we doing now?
So November 11th, Veterans Day, my husband and I, we went to Ninja Noodle with our kids, where you can also throw axe and throwing stars. If you ever come out my way, I'll take you. Well, eventually I can't now. But, and then we drove over to go play pickleball. But I don't remember much after driving away from the restaurant because we got in a really bad accident. It had just gotten dark and we were at a stop sign because you have to go across this 50 mile an hour highway. And I don't remember any of this because of my injuries, but my husband pulled right out in front of someone. We don't think their lights were on, but we couldn't prove it. And so 50 miles an hour, boom, we get T-boned on my husband's side. And luckily his side airbag deployed, and I'm convinced about 100 of our deceased relatives were all there like blocking the way because we were just in a little Prius. And this is my husband's version. It was the worst 3 minutes of his life because he pulled out, heard this screech, boom. He got the wind knocked out of him, but he also broke ribs. And so he thought that his ribs had punctured his lungs because he couldn't breathe. So he looked over at me to say, I can't breathe. And my head's back, blood's coming out of my nose. And he thinks I'm dead. And so obviously, thankfully, that's not what happened. And he got his breath back. And I woke up like 5 minutes later. Then I was kind of in and out of it for a while. I kept back to asking him, where are we? What's going on? My side airbag didn't deploy. So, and I wear glasses to play pickleball. So these are my rose colored glasses, because for very much time on the electronics, it's going to give me a headache. Mm-hmm. But I had glasses on. And so when my head hit the side window, the glasses broke both sides of my nose and my cheekbone and knocked me out. And I got a brain bleed from it. But here, there were so many amazing tender mercies. Two cars behind the car that hit us was a guy from our congregation. And a lot of people were on my husband's side of the car helping him. And he came around to my side. And so I had my eyes closed because any light just really was excruciating. And he took my hand. He says, Beth, this is Zach. And I have no idea who that is. So I opened my eyes and I closed my eyes. I'm like, you're from church? He's like, yeah. I said, what's your name again? It's Zach. Okay. What's your name again? I mean, it wouldn't stay in. Yeah. I had a traumatic brain injury, which you call a TBI. And he just stayed with me and he held my hand because I was so confused and very agitated. And all this chaos is going on with my husband. And I don't know how he is, because he's in this, every time they did something, he just cried out in pain because he had broken two bones in his pelvis and his hip socket and two of his ribs in front. Mm. I had two ribs broken in back and then the bones in my face and then whacked my head. And bless Zach, he just stayed with me. And when they were going to get me the ambulance, and they said, and we had gone down a ravine after the accident, and they said, we'll bring a thing down to you, but we're going to have to, you know, lift you out of the car. I'm like, let me just try and get out because this really hurts. I don't want you to lift me. So I got out and I literally walked with my eyes closed up an embankment, holding on to my buddy Zach and an ambulance person, and got in the ambulance. And Zach stayed there with me, and I asked him for a blessing, which he gave me. And then I said, go find my husband and help him too, which my husband was already off to the hospital by then.
What's your husband's name?
To get him out. His name is Bob.
Bob. So, okay.
And wow. How's Bob doing, Beth?
You know, it was amazing. He is fine now. He was in the hospital 4 days. I was in 3 days, and his diaphragm got messed up too. So he'd have this shooting pain in his shoulder, but we didn't know what that was until like a month later. But he was in a panic because he didn't know how I was. And the whole time he's in the ER, which because of COVID, we couldn't get rooms. Mm. So he got a room the next morning and I got one the next afternoon. But the whole time he's like, how's my wife? And everyone said, oh, we'll go check. And they'd come back and say, she's fine. But they wouldn't tell him anything.
Oh, wow.
Because I was like throwing up the ninja noodle from the concussion and broke. Can you imagine throwing up when your ribs are broken? It is not fun.
Yeah. Wow.
But luckily I don't remember a lot of that. And so that's good. So he's fine now. Had a walker at first, then a cane, had to be on oxygen for about a week because he couldn't breathe right. And his diaphragm was messed up. And so we both slept in the recliner for the first few days and I made it to the bedroom, but it's only been about 3 weeks since he's been able to like sleep in a bed.
Wow.
But we've done great. Our breaks healed wonderfully, really rapidly. I'm really big into healthy living. That my company is Five Pillars of Health. So that helped a lot. All of my medical professionals are like, you're like way ahead of everyone in everything. And I'm like, I don't feel like it. And then they'd say stupid things like, for a 62-year-old, you're normal. I'm like, can I cuss at you now? I wasn't an average 62-year-old. You know, I'm a health and wellness professional and, you know. Yeah. But whatever. So we're doing really good. The hard thing has been the TBI. On TV, it really misrepresents what happens when you get a moderate concussion because you're a mess. You get a lot of different things can happen, but very, very common is insomnia, manic depressive, angry, numb for the first 2 weeks. And I'm an emotional person. So like when I'm happy, I cry. When I'm sad, I cry. I just tears a lot. Numb. for the first 2 weeks, I didn't cry once. And my husband and I go in to see him in the hospital. I waddled down the hall because we were just down the hall from each other. And I went in because I knew I better go see him, but I didn't even care. And that's just so not me. So I sat there holding his hand and he just wept to finally see that I was okay.
Yeah.
Because they never told him what had happened because they didn't want him to know. Because, you know, your wife has a brain bleed, but thankfully it stopped within a few, you know, when they checked it again a few hours later, it had stopped. So that was good. So that's been the hard part, is just the emotional part, the insomnia. And, you know, I could just, before I could do my Tai Chi and my mindfulness and I'd overcome being sad or, you know, situational things. Oh, holy cow. Not good. And I have not cussed since I was a teenager, but the foul language in my head has been crazy. But again, it's just, your brain, it bounces back and forth in your head. And so all these chemicals start releasing and it just does weird things to protect it. So it's been interesting, but I turned the corner after about 2 months to where I wasn't always either depressed or mad. So that's really good. And my cognitive is pretty much back. Occasionally I can't find a word. I can't always think on my feet like I used to be able to, but in general, if I hadn't told you I'd had a severe brain injury or moderate brain injury, you wouldn't know. I know, because I'm like, right. I know that word. Like I forgot how to spell cocoon. Some of the things, if I think long enough, I'll get it back, but I had to look it up. I'm like, I don't know how to spell cocoon. Cause I wanted to be in a cocoon. I was writing in my journal. I wish I just read that thing butterflies are in. So we're doing really, we're just really grateful that we're doing so well. We really saw a lot of miracles and some good things came from it. My husband is a really good man, but for the last month, 2.5 months, he's been an awesome man because he really felt like he had a second chance. He really felt like that should have killed him. And so he has really worked harder at being the guy that walks in the house and notices that the dishes need to be put away. You know, when I'm cooking dinner, can I help you with anything? And when he first started doing that, I'm like, who are you? I'm glad you're here, you know, and not that he wasn't noticing before. If I would say, hey, honey, can you help me with dinner? He'd hop right up. It's not like he wouldn't. He just didn't notice, you know?
Right.
And we shouldn't have to have a life-threatening car accident to do those kind of things.
That's
right?
Okay. That's what we frequently talk about on this program, right? We don't need a cancer diagnosis. We don't need a scare. We don't need this life quake for us to wake up, but like we kind of do.
Yeah.
Right. Because we get into these habits, we get into these mindsets, we get into these channels or grooves, and it's really hard to disrupt that without something traumatic happening.
Well, and I think it helps with couples if we can just be open and talk about things. For example, when my husband and I first got married, he is like a football fanatic. And so whenever football was on, I knew I could say anything. Honey, I'm going to go spend $4,000 and get this and that. And he wouldn't hear it. Never did that. But at first it was like annoying because it's like, I'm talking to you over here. It's the halftime, you know? So I learned that's his space, you know, unless the house is on fire, don't worry about it. And I'm the one, I'm very like, I got to get these things done. Then I can sit down and relax. And he's like, I want to relax now because I'm tired and I'll get to it. So I'd say, hey, can you help me with this? Can I help you in a minute? And I'm like, no, because I'm doing it now. He says, well, why don't you sit down with me and relax? And I finally kind of learned to do that. Just, it's okay if there's dishes in the sink, you know? But it helped to understand that and learn that, because I could have just been ticked off at him that he wouldn't help me when he wanted to. He just was relaxing and we're allowed to relax, right?
Right.
So
how long have you guys been married?
34 years. In April, it will be 35.
34, going on 35. Yeah. Congratulations.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's been a wonderful ride. You know, roller coasters are fun and there's been ups and downs. Yeah. And that was another good thing. We had a period of time where my husband was a little grouchy with the kids. That's the nice Beth version of it. And so some of the kids he didn't have a real good relationship with. But since the accident, it's changed. He is listening differently, to see some of those relationships growing and healing. And that's really a blessing. But so it's, you know, I just love that Heavenly Father blesses us, whether we recognize him doing that or not. Four of our children, our oldest son still is a practicing Latter-day Saint, but the others are not. And the twins stepped away about a year ago. And it's interesting that of my children that have stepped away, It's not just, I don't believe in being a Latter-day Saint. I don't believe in God. I'm like, that's just such a huge step. But it's hard, in my opinion, to continue to believe in God if you don't believe in where your Christian roots were, because you question all the things that you thought were the Holy Spirit. Well, now maybe it was just hormones, you know? And so they don't believe those tender mercies that they had had. Therefore, God must not really be there. It's really an interesting thing I've seen. But so anyway, I love seeing though that you can deny he's there, but he still loves you and he still blesses you and he still helps you in your progression. And if you can just embrace it and be grateful, it's a more joyful journey. But even if you don't embrace it, you still get blessed. And so I'm excited to see where they're going in life, because they're amazing, amazing people, you know. But I call them tender mercies and they call it a coincidence. So
can we talk about that for a second, Beth? Because yeah. I'm curious, you know, there's a lot of people listening to this podcast that are either in the same situation as you are, watching their children kind of take different paths or make different decisions, or they're, you know, they're in the middle of that, right? Kind of seeing them choose a different path than mom and dad did. What advice would you give to those parents that are dealing with that right now, kind of in the beginning stages of that?
I think it's really important to listen to understand versus listen to prove they're wrong. Because there's a difference, you know. If I tried to convince them, that didn't help. I needed to just listen. And I wasn't always good at that with our first son, our second oldest son, Andy. He chose to be extubated, golly, like 7 years ago. He served his, let me back up. So Andy is, I got to use the right term. He's gay, but he is non-binary, which means he doesn't feel like he's a male or a female gender, but he is sexually attracted to men.
Okay.
And he hadn't figured out the non-binary stuff until a few years ago. But once he figured that out, he was a very unhappy, angry kid, and we never could figure out why. And it was because he was gay in a church that back then taught that if you just, the mere fact of being gay was a sin. You know, back in the Spencer W. Kimball, those days where, you know, that was carnal, sensual, devilish, whether you acted on it or not. So he didn't even want to allow himself to believe that's what he was. Excuse me. But once he embraced that, it was just freeing for him. And he had some really powerful experiences. The Easter after he embraced that, which just a few weeks after he embraced it, he just felt a real powerful love from the Savior and felt like it was okay, that God loved him. He wasn't a mistake. And that was so important, so important. And it's kind of funny that he didn't share this with us, even though our twins had several really good friends that were gay in their intermediate school. And so we'd have a lot of discussions at dinner about how the kids would bully them, and other Christian, really conservative Christian kids were mean to those of their friends. And they're like, how can they be this way? And so we had a lot of discussion on how they could still be kind to their Christian friends who were being mean to their gay friends, you know? So our son should have known it was safe, but he didn't share. So once he embraced that, then he decided he could go on a mission. So he didn't go on a mission until he was 21, and he went to Washington State, had a wonderful experience, and lost a ton of weight. And he called it the happiness diet, because he didn't hate himself anymore, you know, and just had a great, great experience. And he came home from his mission and he said, you know, you can't take the Mormon out of me, even though I'm gay. But here's the hard thing. If you're gay and you want to have intimate relationships, but you're not attracted to a woman, it's really hard. So you kind of, in a conservative Christian world, it's either be celibate your whole life or break your covenants, because marrying someone of the opposite gender and it repulsive to you to kiss them or to be intimate with them, I mean, that's just not a good mix at all. So he just planned on like finding other ways to find happiness and joy. But after a while, he liked, and he would be on forums where others were doing the same thing, but everyone was just white knuckling it. He's like, this isn't happiness. And so he decided that he was going to start dating guys. And he's like, but I'm going to keep the, especially for you stuff, you know, I'm not going to, you know, go over the top till I'm married. And he says, and then at that point, I'll probably get excommunicated. I'm like, well, it depends on what you're doing, what you're saying, but regardless. But as soon as he decided to start dating, he told his branch president, and they immediately chose to have a court. You know, it's not called that anymore. What's it called now? There's a different name now that's nicer.
Membership council.
Yeah. Membership council. And what's interesting, as I was waiting there with him, he said, you don't have to come. I said, I want to come. This is a big deal. He wanted to be excommunicated. I was the one that was hanging on. And they were in there 2 hours because Andy is beloved. He is just such an amazing, gentle, giant, amazing person. But the bottom line is, he's like, I'm not going to stop doing this. I have to figure this out. And this is a path I have to take to do it. And so he was excommunicated. And, you know, when they came out with the decision, the stake president, who we'd known forever, we'd lived there 25 years. He's like, you know, your son is just such a great kid. We just really love him. I'm like, yeah, I love him too. He's like, you know, Andy, we'll get you a letter to let you know. And I didn't, no one told me what had happened yet, you know? Mm-hmm. And so then I said, so what'd y'all decide? And he's like, oh, Andy's going to be excommunicated. And I just stood there. I just couldn't say anything. And then they shook hands and off they went. And I just literally dissolved into tears on my son's chest. And he was okay with it because he knew. Now, years later, I realized he needed to be released from those covenants because he wasn't going to keep them. And that is a loving thing to do. It's not a mean thing to do. And he still intended to go to church and stuff, which he did for a little while. But shortly after that was when the church, for a period of time, announced that any gay couple that had children, those children could not receive, they couldn't be, I can't remember the word now, blessed in church or baptized without approval from the first presidency. Now, what many people don't know is anyone that asked the first presidency for that approval received it. Many people don't know that that happened, but because I'm very involved in North Star and other support groups for people of faith who want to keep their covenants, I was able to learn that. But anyway, that was hard for him to hear. It was hard for us to hear. We thought it was a mistake. And at the time I was in public affairs, and I thought, I always hear about stuff before it hits the news media. How can this be? You know, but it had leaked out, and I checked on my sources and it was true. And it was a great experience for my husband and I, because we really didn't like hearing that, but we talked to Heavenly Father all day about it. And we talked to each other about it. And we talked to our son about it, who was very angry. And he said, I'm done. I'm not going to church again. But we realized it was to protect the family. You don't want these poor kids being in a family that's different than what everyone else's family is like, and all the things that go along with it, you know. So that was kind of a hard thing. But we always let Andy know we loved him no matter what he did, you know. Mm-hmm. As all of our children knew that, because then our third son, who was messed up in drugs and a mess for a while, we were always visiting him in jail, and, you know, and he knew we loved him. We just wouldn't bail him out. And so it's hard when you have children making choices that you might not agree with, but it helps you appreciate how Father must feel about me. When he's like, oh, Beth being stupid again, but I love her. You gotta That's love right. her, That's right. you know? And so it's taught me a little bit more about how deeply Father loves me and all of his children because of how deeply I love my son, you know. Now, I have heard of people that kick their children out and all kinds of stuff, and it makes me sad. But hopefully the time will come that they will realize, you know what, Christ, you know, who is he always with? The sinners, you yeah. know. And so it's really important to try and understand. And like, as our children have had different things come up, I'd say, like, explain that to me. I don't understand that. And then they'll explain it. And I'll still, in my mind, I might think, I don't agree with that, but I get that they do. And so I'm not going to make fun of it. You know, I'm just not going to live it or, you know, so we all have kind of agreed to disagree. We still have conversations. But now because we're all at places where we're adults and mature, they're not yelling matches or anything. We just talk and try and understand. And when our son told us he was non-binary, I'm like, okay, what's that? You know.
I'm curious, Beth, about your own faith journey and where with your children, you're looking at their path and their walk and what that looks like.
where does your faith come from? Can you talk a little bit about your faith journey?
Sure. And sure.
That'd be great.
Well, the conversion story, you just got to hear because that's just amazing. So I grew up in Arizona where there's a lot of Latter-day Saints, but I never heard, never made the connection, even though I saw the commercials, you know, that they always did. My mom is a Catholic. She's the 12th of 12 kids. And, you know, it was a tradition, not necessarily a profession of faith. She married my dad, who I can't say he didn't believe. He just didn't ever talk about it. But my mom was his fifth wife. And I didn't even know he had five wives. I knew he'd had one more because I have a half brother. But when I did family history, I'm like, oh, really? Go figure. But because she married a man who was divorced, this was before Vatican II, that was considered adultery. So she could no longer take the communion and the sacraments and stuff. And she believed she wasn't worthy of that. Even after Vatican II, I says, Mom, you can go do that now. She says, no, I shouldn't. I sinned by marrying your dad. I'm like, that just made me sad. So we never really went to church. We were kind of the Christmas Easter churchgoers, but learned how to do the sit, stand, kneel in the Catholic church, you know. But I had a dear friend since first grade, my best friend, Louise Bisson, Weesey. We were buddies ever since first grade. And in the fourth grade, our family moved to the same street that she lived on. It was the first time we finally owned a house. And so I went to church with her, to her Methodist church. Fell in love with that. I'd like to just point out here that Joseph Smith was leaning towards the Methodist church, just saying, and loved it. I was an usher in high school. I was an usher for the second service and was very involved in the youth group and loved it. Would go to youth retreats. And the question I always asked is they like, make a picture of your, what God means to you. And I'd always put a question mark. Cause I'm like, I had never felt him. I didn't know how to feel him. I didn't have anything to help me understand that. But then when I was getting ready, excuse me, to be confirmed into the Methodist church, they showed a video about the gift of the Holy Ghost and how it was like fire. So I was really excited because I'm like, finally, I'll feel it. And when I got confirmed, all these different ministers put their hands on my head and I felt nothing. And I walked away from that thinking I must just be a horrible sinner because I didn't feel anything. Now, mind you, I didn't smoke and drink because my parents were alcoholics and smokers and their health was a mess. I didn't play around. I had no intentions of having sex before marriage. So I was a really, really good person in the grand scheme of things, but I believed the lies I was hearing in my head that I must not be good enough. So my last year in high school, my senior year in high school, I was in student government and our student body president happened to be a Latter-day Saint. And I interacted with him a lot and was at his house working on some stuff before graduation. And he went off to baseball practice. And his mom, bless Barbara Wood forevermore, she is my hero. She said, hey, Beth. Now, she said several things. She taught me about the 3 degrees of glory, which was kind of mind-blowing for someone who never heard that. But, and I asked my youth minister about it. He's like, I don't know much about that, which he did. I found out later. But nonetheless, she says, when you go away to school, because I was going to go up to NAU in Flagstaff, she said, if you want to get in with kids that are like you, that don't smoke and drink, go over to the Institute of Religion. And in my mind, I'm thinking institute. So that's like where crazy people go. You know, the lingo is just different. And I'm like, yeah, whatever. My roommate was my Methodist minister's daughter, you know? So we were doing intramurals. We went to the Methodist church up there and it was very different. A lot of sophistication because most of them were professors and snooty. So we're like, ah, we're not going to go back there. But I just felt this emptiness. So one day I decided, you know what? I'd seen where the Institute was. And after practice, I'd been practicing badminton, an intramural game. And I walked over there in my short shorts and my tank top, walked into the Institute, immediately felt, it feels nice in here. Didn't know what that meant. I just knew it felt nice. Walked up to the Institute secretary and said, I am not a Latter-day Saint. I don't want to be a Latter-day Saint, but I want to take a Bible study class, not a Book of Mormon, because I don't believe in that thing. Do you guys offer Bible study classes? And she was smiling just like, Mike is smiling. She's like, yeah, we can help you with a class. So signed up for a Bible study class. She said, I'd like to introduce you to the director of the Institute. Again, I'm thinking like a director of a corporation, a big gun. And I'm in like workout clothes. I'm like, no, I don't want to meet him. No, just go. So she takes me in to meet Brother Garner. Mr. Garner, nice to meet you. And we're chatting and he gets to know me. And then he says, have you ever thought about being in a sorority? I said, no. I grew up in an alcoholic home and saw what that does. So I don't believe in drinking. and smoking and playing around. And that's pretty much what I think goes on at sororities. So no, thank you. He says, well, there's another type of sorority. Have you ever heard of Lambda Delta Sigma, which is it doesn't exist anymore. It was the LDS sorority. They're having Rush Week. Would you like to join them? If they just talk about service and charity and kindness. Sure. So I go to Rush Week and make some really great friends. And so I'm kind of there from the beginning of school almost. And one of the gals, she and I become good friends. We're walking back to campus and she says, hey, would you like to go to a baptism this Saturday? Sure. So I go to the baptism, and being the worldly person I am, and I'm used to these preachers that practice for weeks. The speaker was horrible because, you know, he probably, you know how speakers are. Some of them just aren't that good, right? He was terrible. And the poor girl getting baptized was in those wonderful white jumpsuits that, in a very snooty girl's opinion, mine, looked ridiculous. And so I was embarrassed for how she looked. The guy was a horrible speaker, but it just felt so nice there. And I couldn't figure out what I was feeling. I had no clue I was feeling the Holy Spirit. So then after that, she says, you know, there's a fireside tomorrow. Would you like to go? Even though the baptism was a disaster, I'm like, sure, because I'm thinking a campfire outside in the woods, this will be a blast. No, yet again, duped by the Latter-day Saints. So I go to the fireside, and how wonderful it was. The speaker had just returned as the mission president, President Reardon. So he's giving this amazing talk, and he's talking about preparing to go on missions. And he's like, now you young ladies, you should be thinking about going on a mission too. And he turns to me, you, have you thought about going on a mission? Now, the few people around me that were in Lambda Delta Sigma knew I wasn't Latter-day Saint, but most of the people didn't, because I just kind of been there. And so I heard them literally go, when he asked the question. And I had always wanted to be in the Peace Corps, which in my mind is a mission. So I'm like, yeah, sure. And you're like, see, you girls should be thinking about that. And so these things are all happening, and I'm kind of clueless about what's going on. But then as we were walking home from that, I had felt the Spirit so strong, and I'd been praying a lot about it and thinking maybe I should look closer into this. And she had told me that, you know, the missionaries could teach me and stuff. And I had been praying, and I felt like maybe there's something to this church. And so I told her, I said, you know, I think there might be something to this church. Do you think the missionaries would teach me now? She's like, yeah, I think we could talk them into it. So the first discussion was a video, which I'm so old that it was a reel to reel video. Okay. You know, it goes from one reel across to the other. And when Heavenly Father and the Savior appeared to Joseph Smith, I felt the Spirit so strong. And every time since then, I feel the Spirit so strong. And I finally connected, duh, that's the Spirit. And so it was wonderful taking the discussions. I decided, okay, I better break it to my mom and dad that I'm going to be baptized. And so I called up my mom and said, hey, I've decided I'm going to join the Mormon Church. And there's a pause on the other end of the line. And this is one of my hinge moments in my life. My mother taught me what it's like to be a good mother. She said, you know, Beth, you've gone through a lot of changes. You're living on your own now. You're in a school environment that's tougher than what you're used to. And this is a big decision to make. Do you think you should be making a decision like this in such a short time? And of course, my first thought is, you can't tell me what to do. You're not the boss of me. I didn't say that, but I thought it. But I honored the fact that one of the commandments said, honor thy father and thy mother. And I thought, what's 30 more days? And I said, okay. But in 30 days, if I decide that, will you and daddy come up? She's like, I don't know, but just give it 30 days. So I did. And of course, nothing changed. I still wanted to. And a couple of days before I was going to be baptized, I finally had the courage to call her. And I said, will you come? And she's like, no, I don't think I can do that. Because, you know, the Catholic Church is the only true church. So she, in her mind, she couldn't do that. I'm like, okay. Well, the day before my baptism, she called and said, can you get a hotel for your dad and I? We're coming up. So that is huge. Even though she didn't agree with my decision, she was there to support me. I mean, can you see what that taught me, right?
Huge.
Yeah.
And the biggest concern I had when I was going to be baptized and confirmed is that when I received the gift of the Holy Ghost, I really worried that it was going to be the same way as before. And so I fasted and I prayed. And so the day I was baptized, I was fasting. And the family that introduced me to the church, her husband, Teddy, he was the one that was going to confirm me. And side funny note, they only filled the font about this deep. I mean, it was deeper than that, but dunk me three times before he could get me under. Oh, and my mom's like, goodness. You were just such a mess. It took three times to get rid of all your sins. You know. So we're in the Relief Society room, all these wonderful priesthood holders that I'd grown to love around me, plus a man I dearly loved, Teddy Wood, was going to confirm me. He laid his hands on my head and he began the blessing. And from the tip of my head to the tip of my toes, I was on fire. And I just wept because Father knew I needed a miracle. I needed a miracle to just get rid of that worry so I would never have to ever worry again. Is this really it? But here's the kicker. After it was over, Brother Wood fell back on the table and sat on the table and he looked at the men and he said, "Brethren, did you feel that?" And I had not said anything. And so he felt it too. And that was important to me then, but it was even more important to me later when my twins who were talking about, oh, you know, this can confuse you, that can confuse you. I'm like, you could say I dreamed up feeling that fire, but how did Ted Wood feel it too? That's a witness. And another reason why we need second witnesses, you know, to that. And so that has really grounded me because I cannot deny it. I don't profess that everything that happens in any church is of God, because look at the Crusades. I mean, look at things that have been done in horrible atrocities done in the name of religion. And I'm sure Father just cries in his heartbroken that we tie him into that mess. And I know in the Latter-day Saint Church, people are imperfect. There's cultures and there's traditions that get messy, but that doesn't change that I know that this is where Father wants me. And so that's my faith. And when I was black and white to begin with, and now I'm more, okay, there's love in the middle in there somewhere too.
Yeah, I think that what Ted Wood did in that moment isn't happening enough, right? Like, I think that we need to be better at identifying when we feel the Holy Ghost, right? So that it is a shared experience.
Exactly. And,
you know, Tyler, I know you were just recently talking to a group of kids and it's like, what does this feel like? Like, do we know this? Do we know the language of the Spirit? And as we're better at identifying it, like Teddy did in that moment,
yes,
right? You walk away with a gem of a memory that's probably going to help steer you a lot down the road.
And bless him, we met up with them. I always would visit him. Every time I was in Arizona, I'd go visit him. They're like my Mormon parents, I call them. And one time they met us for lunch and all the kids were there too. And we got done with lunch and he said, "I need to tell your kids about the most spiritual experience I've ever had." He says, "Now kids, I want you to understand, I've been a bishop. I've been in a state presidency. I've had a lot of really sweet spiritual experiences, but I have never felt the Spirit as strong as when I confirmed your mom as a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints." So I was really glad he shared that testimony with me. So we need to identify those sweet moments, mm-hmm. like you're saying, Mike, afterwards too, right? Yeah, anytime we can share those experiences. So
absolutely. Thanks for sharing that, Beth.
Can I fast forward a little bit? Right.
So you talked about
your kids and maybe their struggles, and just we all know folks that are struggling. And you talked about stepping away. How do you, you're a long ways removed from that baptism.
Mm-hmm. 44 years.
Yeah. 40. And as strong as it felt then, I'm sure that flame is still burning. How do you keep your faith?
For me, it was an evolution. At first, I read my scriptures because that's what you're supposed to do. But it was more to just get, you know, a chapter read. And occasionally I'd feel something, but most of the time I was confused. I mean, I can remember asking really dumb questions when the missionaries were teaching me, like, "What's the fruit of your loins?" And they all blushed because I'm like, "I've never heard that. You know, what does that mean?" And later I'm like, "Oh my gosh, they probably were dying when I asked that question." But then I was on a mission, obviously I started studying differently. We called it tuning up, where you would read a scripture, you'd write down your first thoughts, then you'd read it again, looking for what message was there. Then you'd read it again, how to apply it to you. And wow, does that make a difference when you read the scriptures? It just does. And so that kind of set me on a trajectory, but I still wasn't always good at taking the time to do that. On a mission, it's a lot easier, you know? And so I, to be honest, I would say I was probably in my 30s before I really started searching the scriptures like I do now. And it's even better than it was, you know, 20 years ago. It's kind of a process figuring it out, but there's gems in everything. And a treasure that I find that I heard from an institute teacher, when you're studying the scriptures, it's like, ask what is the message here? Wonder why did that get included, you know, versus the million other things that could have been included. And then ponder on Christ. How does this relate to Christ? How does this relate to us understanding? So I learned to really ponder more. And that has just been invaluable because I start my morning always. I decided in my 30s that it was worth giving up 30 minutes of sleep to have a devotional where I included scripture and prayer and study. And, you know, it's worth losing 30 minutes of sleep over. And that was a game changer. It was. And so I have a scripture journal, and in my journal, sorry, I'm overcoming a cold, which we actually found out is COVID. Oh, wow. I thought it was a cold. Nope, that's okay. Quarantine's over tomorrow.
That's funny.
Yeah, I was so proud for 2 years. I'm so healthy, I'll never get it. Nope, not when you have three people over a four-day period breathing on you that have COVID. One of my medical professionals. Oops. Anyway, back to where we were. I start out with prayer, obviously, to just have the Spirit. And while I'm praying, I'm saying, okay, Father, who is it that you need me to reach out to today? And many times it's an immediate. And so I literally will stop my prayer, do what he said to do. If it's like text someone, because do you know what, when you text, you guys know that you're younger than me, you can like schedule a text to go. So at 5 a.m, instead of me texting sister so-and-so, I've set it and go. Or I will write it down. And then I'll have my scripture study where I'm seeking to learn from it. But I always have a space after that where it'll be Father's hand today. And I'll write down from the day before what tender mercies I'd experienced, many of which we miss. They're so little. And my family calls me Pollyanna, and I wear that badge with great pride. If we're driving down the freeway and Tyler cuts me off, I'm going to assume that he's racing to one of his kids' baseball tournaments because they fell and broke their arm and he needs to go help them. Even though maybe Tyler's just not paying attention, or maybe Tyler's just a jerk today. It doesn't matter what he is, right? But what I think about it does matter, because that changes my day. And so I am that kind of, I believe that way. And I'm glad I do, because I'm a lot happier, you know, and I don't have to worry about road rage. So I think it helps to show gratitude, though, because I heard a speaker say once that 98% of the time that you have a good idea of something to do, it's a prompting. So rather than miss it, just act on it every time. And 2% of the time, it's not a prompting. But so what if it's telling you to do something good, right? So I just attribute anything that comes into my brain as from Heavenly Father, even if it's like, go visit sister so-and-so, and you go there and she's not home. But I'll tell you, after that, I'm always, every time I go by her house, I pull in because I know I got to see her, I guess. And it may be more about me being obedient and being trusted than about sister so-and-so needing me, you know? And I've learned that miracles don't have an expiration date in helping us understand what they're about, if we'll continue to ponder on them. My oldest son, Tyler, before his mission, I had a really interesting experience. I'm sidetracking you, but that's what happens with me.
That's all right.
But it helps you understand the faith part of it.
Yeah.
I was driving, I'd been at a, I was in a leadership position at church, and I was driving from that to choir practice. And as I was driving, just, you know, not really thinking of anything, lightning bolt in my head, you are going to die. And I'm like, okay. And I thought, what does that mean? And then the next thing that I get is, the next time you see a police officer, go over to him and thank him for his service. Well, my degree's in criminal justice, so I do have a love for people in law enforcement anyway. But I thought, well, that's weird, but whatever. Go to choir. And thinking on it, didn't tell anyone about it, because that's kind of okay. What is that about? About 4 days later, my son and I, my son Tyler and I was driving him over to pick up his car that was in the shop. And he was not on his mission yet. And the way we went, they had just turned a two-way stop into a traffic signal. And so when I pulled up to the stop light, directly across from us, it was red, there was a police officer. And for a split, and then it turned green. And for a split second, I thought, I need to go over because that's what I was told to do. But I paused for a minute thinking, should I do that now or not? And that pause saved my life. And had I not had that thought, I wouldn't have paused, because someone who didn't know that this, I wasn't at a stop sign, that it was, I had the green light, busted through the light going 40 miles an hour. And I just thought, wow, that's how I could have died, right? And then, of course, the cop chased after him, so I couldn't thank him, but I watched for him. I finally caught him later, and I thanked him and told him the story just because I thought he needed to hear that story. And, you know, when you're in a place where lots of people are people of faith, you're kind of safe telling those stories. And I thought that was the end of the story. But then the next time I was in the temple, I was doing an Ishtar work. And for those of you who are not Latter-day Saints, there's different things you do. But in one of it, it talks about Latter-day Saints wear special underclothing that is sacred. And it's, we believe, both a spiritual and a physical protection. And when I was in that room where they were talking about it, the spirit hit me again, that it was because I was keeping my covenants and wearing those sacred garments, that it not only protected me, but it protected my son. And I thought, holy cow. I'd never made the connection that my covenants, I know my kids are mine forever, no matter what they do, as long as I keep my covenants, right? But that helped me make that connection. And that was like a couple months later. And as I ponder on it more, I get another little nugget. And so I think it's really important that when we have moments like that, that we write them down. Because Satan, and by the way, Satan does not have a capital S. That's a lowercase s. He doesn't deserve a capital S, just saying. Satan wants us to forget. But when we write it down, we can go back and read it. And how grateful am I now that I've written things down? Because a lot of things after the accident, they're gone. I can't remember them. Things I've learned back, but those treasures would have been gone forever had I not written them down. And I'm so grateful that I've written them down. So it's really important to me, because my scripture journal is kind of scripture slash journal. I can read what I learned in that scripture that day, and I know what was going on with my family. I know what I was worried about. Sometimes it's written specifically in there. Sometimes I remember. And so having holy habits are really important, and stretching a little bit. If it's not inconvenient to do and a little bit of a sacrifice, then we probably don't have enough skin in the game. And we need to think about, okay, how could I do this better? So that's how I keep the faith.
I love that idea of stretching, right? Tyler, I sent you that quote from a General Conference address where they quoted President Nelson, you know, if we want to receive more faith, we have to do things that require more faith, right? And looking at our faith, and I love that holy habits, and looking at what is it that we're doing? Why are we doing them? And how can we use these habits and these things that we're doing to increase our faith?
Yeah.
I think that's powerful.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I've decided, and it's no big brilliant deduction, but the hard things are in our life are what change us. That's what consecrates us. That's what can make us a better Christian or a cynic. And so if we can just look at those hard things, and I've trudged through a lot of crap, it's worth it though, because of where I've become. And it lets me know that I can become even better if I'm willing to trudge through some more crap. I mean, like this car accident, horrible, horrible. When it first happened, I'm like, I'm going to crawl up into a cave and never come out, because my greatest joy, because one of the gifts Heavenly Father has given me is the gift of being able to express myself well and being able to sense people's feelings. And I'm a really dynamic, good public speaker. I'm a good keynote speaker. And so with my business, that's what I do. And I teach classes and seminars, and I can tell what's going on, and I know where to go with it. And I love that. And I was like a bubbling idiot after the accident. And I was like, my life is over. The thing that brings me the greatest joy, I'm not going to be able to do. And so when I finally got to see the speech neurotherapist, and I'm like, okay, I had not even cried yet. I was sitting there with my sunglasses on because the light hurt my eyes. I'm like, okay, so I can't find my words. I'm really mad all the time. I hate my life, you know, and I just want to crawl up in a cave. And she's like, well, let me ask you, can you read a book and comprehend it? I said, yeah, I've been doing, you know, quiet reading because I have to go in quiet rooms a lot because people's noise. And I had my whole family there for Thanksgiving, like, oh! She's like, but can you comprehend that? I said, yeah. She says, then you're going to make a full recovery. I said, can you say that again? She says, if you can read and comprehend, she says, now I'm not talking technical stuff, like all those medical studies that you read about Tai Chi, just regular stuff, you will make a full recovery. And I literally started crying. The dam finally broke because I had hope. I had hope. I still haven't restarted my business yet though, but I'm hoping to in March. But I mean, I was just, wow. So it was only 2 months. And I think of people that have to live the rest of their life that way. I mean, I'm really grateful because some people have a severe brain injury and they are never the same again ever. And so I really count that as a tender mercy. And I will, given the, as my husband calls it, the second chance that he's had, the awakening, given that, I'd go through it all again. But now we add some of these other pieces that we're putting into it. Absolutely. I have such compassion for people. I'm Pollyanna. I'm always happy. So even though I work with a lot of people that have anxiety and depression, I don't get it because I don't have that. You know, I don't get it. Holy crap. I get it now. I totally get it now. And I've evolved my Tai Chi to where when we're moving our hands a certain way, I tell them, okay, you're going to inhale now. And when you exhale, I want you to think of something negative. What are you worried about? Is it anxiety? Is it depression? Is it pain? So you're going to push that pain away. And when you inhale, you're going to pull in relief, or you're exhaling and you're pushing away anxiety and you're pulling in peace. I've evolved because I saw how it's helping me. So I'm a better teacher now and I can empathize. You know, it's okay to... You can be empathetic, but it's different when you've really experienced it. Mm-hmm. So I'm grateful for that. I can't wait to start doing my stuff again because I can understand better. And of course, everyone loves a good story. And I can say, see, I wear rose colored glasses the whole time.
Right? Well, I was going to ask you, Beth, you know, one of the things that we talk a lot about with our guests are things that we've learned the hard way in life. And, you know, you this experience of understanding other people and becoming more empathetic, I think obviously is learned the hard way. But are there lessons that stand out to you that you've learned the hard way?
You know, the couple things, and I learned one of them with my son Andy when he left the church. And this is stupid, but I still feared it. I feared because I believe his voice is a gift from God. I mean, it's just amazing. And I feared that he would lose that gift because he stepped away. Now that's stupid of me to think that, but I didn't understand fully how deeply Father loved him at that point. I get it now. And so the first time we went, he did this beautiful junior concert at his junior college where it was just him singing the whole time, German, French, English, fabulous. But when I was there, I was a little nervous thinking, okay, is he going to like miss a note here and there? How's he going to remember? It was fabulous. It was fabulous. And I just wept. And I felt Father tell me, I don't stop loving him just because he doesn't do what I want. He's got to figure it out. And that was huge to learn because, again, that helped me be a little bit better parent too, because I had more kids to let it go with, right? I did not make the connections about how amazing my mom was until 20 years after that event. Maybe 30 years after that event. I mean, it took a little while for me to get how amazing my mom was because I always thought of her as an addict. It was a not very nice addict when she was drunk. Funny, great sense of humor. And when she was sober, nice, you know. But I look at her so differently now. And that's a good thing because, like, she lives with me. So, so that was one that I learned how deeply Father loved us. And the other thing, I learned to give myself grace. Because when you look at choices your children make, when you've taught them different, it's easy to say, if I'd have just done this different, if family home evening would have been less contentious, because I know we all know most family home evenings are a disaster, right? Mm. Most of the times, occasionally we get a nugget. When they get older, we get a few more nuggets, but they're, you know, but all those what ifs start going through your head. And I remember, I'll share a couple, my son, Spencer, the redhead. For a couple of years, he was just a mess. Alcohol, drugs, a disaster. But before the disaster, he was always unhappy. And we learned later he had insomnia issues. He was ADD. He had depression. And he'd be the one that would push everyone's buttons. So at the end of a camping trip, because we loved to camp, we'd finally gotten everyone packed in, but he'd been a turkey the whole time. And I had a blazing headache because I was still eating gluten and sugar. And because I didn't know any better, right?
Hard to camp and, without sugar.
That's I know, true. Right? Oh, man. I've adapted some really good recipes, though, I'll tell you. Coconut blossom sugar, good stuff. And so I was halfway through this apple. We get in the car, and I'm like, okay, let's just go. And of course, Spencer's pushing his sister's button, and they're in the back. And I'm like, Spencer, leave your sister alone. Spencer. And it wasn't stopping. So being the really kind and amazing mother that I am, I turn around, and with all the strength I had, threw my apple at his head. Thankfully, it missed and he moved. And so it slammed into the back window, splattered, total silence in the car. The rest of the drive home, no one talked. And my first thought is, I'm the worst mother in the universe. Right? So you would think, but what's funny is when I ask the kids, go clean that up, like, no, mom, we want to leave that there. another time, having fun with him, you know, you look for creative parenting moments to give them natural consequences. So we do silly things like if they abused the furniture, they couldn't sit on it for 24 hours because the furniture was afraid of them. So one day, our son Spencer loved to slam the door because he would have rages. And he slammed the door before he went to school, and then he finally went off to school. And I'm like, I couldn't wait. As soon as he was out the door, my other son went later because he was in intermediate school. I said, Tyler, come up here. I need your help. He says, hold the door while I take it off the hinges. So I took the door off the hinges, hid it in my bedroom. And I could not wait for him to get home from school that day. So he gets home and he goes upstairs, put away his backpack, walk, 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 silence. And then I'm just sitting down there like the Cheshire cat smile. And he's like, Mom, where's my door? I said, well, son, that's not how we treat doors. They're for privacy and for, you know, solitude. They're not for slamming and showing emotion. So for the next week, you don't get a door. What? Yeah. Oh, I loved it. Now, he was really mad at me, but it was a good way to teach a lesson, I thought. I'll tell you, to the moment when he could have the door back up, I'm like, I don't have time to put it up now. No problem. I'll put it on. Where's the stuff? So those kind of bad parenting moments all come into your head. Other things that are worse too. And you think, oh gosh, what have I done to my son? Especially that son who was a big challenge, went through the drugs and alcohol, all that mess there. But because we did tough love and loved him anyway, you guys probably remember Hurricane Harvey, right? In mm-hmm. Houston, worst hurricane ever. And we, of course, were right in the zone of it, and it flooded our street and everything. Well, the night of the hurricane, it had rained really a little bit the day before, but we thought that was it. But the real rain came later that night, and it was just my mom and I at home because my husband and one of our twins and Spencer had gone to a friend's house to watch that stupid boxing match that was that night. So they were gone, and it starts raining harder and harder. Pretty soon the streets are flooded, so they can't come home. So there's 20 people staying at this person's house, and the water's rising, and we're fine, you know, because we were up a little bit. And I'd done some fun jerry rigging to keep the rain from coming in our door because it was flooding the back porch, but I fixed it all by myself. Woof. And but my son Spencer just worried about us because he deeply loved me in spite of all that, because it was good parenting anyway, even though it was hard parenting. And so he told my husband, I'm going to go home. There's crazy people out. I know crazy people, Dad. You don't know the life I've lived. They're going to take advantage and they're going to break in and hurt mom and grandma. And my son, Bob's like, no, they're not. They're fine. He insisted. And so, and then his sister Sarah's like, I'm going to go with them. And my husband's like, you know, people die when they're trying to go through this. So Bob took Spencer outside and said, listen, I know I can't talk you out of this, but if you're going to go, go now, because I literally will physically restrain your sister because I can't let her go with you. And so off he went. And then Bob calls me and says, so Spencer's waiting home. I'm like, what? You know, because it's really dangerous. When the flood's going, the water pushes manholes up and you can fall in a manhole and drown. There's all kinds of crazy, and if in addition to sewage, there's all kinds of crazy things floating like fire ants and roaches and snakes and alligators. So I was in public affairs. And so I knew the emergency management guy had his cell phone. I called him. I said, "Hey, listen, this is Beth." He says, "Yeah." He says, "My son is waiting home. Can you use one of your rescue vehicles and find him and bring him?" He's like, "We'll see what we can do." So they found him, but they were only going to take him to the fire station. He's like, "Nope, not going with you." So this young man wades across flooded rivers, water up to his shoulders, roaches crawling up on him because they're trying to find something dry. And I'm at the window praying till 3 in the morning. And I see him trudging up the sloshing up the water, and I go running out there in the rain, and I grab him. I was so grateful, so grateful. And that was the dumbest thing and the most loving thing he'd ever done. But what it told me is, in spite of all the ugly that we had had during the addiction years, when he knew we loved him, but he didn't then because he was an addict. That was a real reminder that he was really literally willing to give his life for his mom. And that's huge.
Yeah.
That's huge. And it helped me to realize that a parent's love is really important and that we need to not let him down. And so those were like hinge moments when I realized you just don't stop loving them when they don't agree with what you do. And so as each child kind of decided to do things I didn't agree with, it's not that it was easy. It was hard, but you just don't stop loving them. And so those are hard lessons to learn, because lots of times we want to be mad at them because they're not doing what we told them, and they're my kid and it's my way or the highway, you know? And even when they're adults, it's really tricky parenting adults, but it's also wonderful. So
how do you, thinking of your own parents, how do you honor them today?
Well, my dad had bad genes. And so because he smoked and drank, he died at 63. So this coming year, I will have outlived my dad. And what's so weird is when he was so old and frail, to me, he reminded me of like an 80-year-old, but he's only 63. But he was, you know, he was such a good man. He was career Coast Guard until he met my mom, and that's why that marriage lasted. But he would literally give his shirt off his back for a stranger. I remember we had gone to pick him up at the airport, and when we were driving home, there was a Navy guy hitchhiking, and he picked him up and drove him way out of the way just to get him home. You know, he was just a good man. And when I decided that I wanted to go on a mission for our church, mom was not really excited about that. She's like, "What? You're giving up your car and your career?" And I'm like, "Yeah, that's why I put myself through school in 3 years instead of 4. So when I hit 21, I could go." And my dad was at the bar, and I wanted to get his opinion. So I went to the corner bar, and because it was a family bar, that's what I grew up in, is bars. And I said, "Hey, Dad, this is what I'm wanting to do. What do you think about that?" And he had tears in his eyes, and he said, "Whatever you do, I support you." You know, so even though they made lifestyle choices that harmed them and harmed us as a family, they loved me as best they could. You know, he was just a really good man. And I'll tell you, at his funeral, every single person had just an amazing story to tell what a good man he was. And so I honor him now by keeping living that, being the kind of person that people love and felt my love, you know. And my mom, bless her little pointed heart, she smoked for 60 years. So now she has COPD and emphysema and is on oxygen. And because she's an alcoholic, before she moved in with us about 8 years ago, for the year before she moved in, she was always falling down and breaking something, because either she was too drunk and falling down, or she was smoking and fainted and fell down. And my sister still lived in Arizona and was having to deal with all that by herself. And my sister had never experienced addiction the way I had, where I went to 12-step programs so I could understand it. I know the steps. I've worked the steps, and I'm not even an addict, but you have to work them as a loved one of an addict to understand and to heal, because you're hurt. You're broken too, trying to figure it all out. And so she'd get really kind of mad at my mom and think, you know, addicts will tell you what you want to hear. And they mean it, usually. I mean, like my mom, when she told my sister, "I promise I won't do it again," she meant it until she needed a drink again. Mm-hmm. And it's a disease. But my sister felt like if she loved me enough, she wouldn't do that. And so finally it got to the point where my sister's in healthcare. And so the ER doctor said, "So if she keeps coming, she can't take care of herself. You guys have to do something, or I have to report her to kind of the CPS for old people." And so I told my sister, "Listen," and my husband, who is a saint, because which of you two would like your alcoholic mother-in-law to move in with you? Just saying.
It's a tough one. I love my mother-in-law. I want to go on record. I want to be go on record and make sure she knows that.
Good move. Yeah. So he's a saint. I said, you know, and we had talked about it before we got to that point. He's like, yeah, we just have to do that. And so when she got out of the hospital on Tuesday, my sister said, a choice. We can move you to a convalescent home or you can go move and live at Beth's. So I won. And by Thursday, we were on our way there before she could change her mind. And by Saturday, we had turned around and we were driving back to Texas with her. Mm. And it hit her about New Mexico, what had just happened to her. And she started crying. And she thought in her mind, it was just, I'll just be there a couple months and then I'll get to go home. I'm like, you're never going home, Mom. So the first year was not fun. But what's wonderful is after that first year, because I had learned how to deal with addicts with my son. So I didn't enable her and I did tough love. And so on my birthday, we went to the store because she would drive those little carts in the store. She's like, I want to get you a special birthday gift. So I don't want you to go with me in the store and I'll meet you in the meat department. And I knew exactly what she was going to do. She's going to go get cigarettes. So given that my career previously was arresting shoplifters, I knew how to follow her without being seen. And it wasn't that hard. She went straight to the register where they sell the cigarettes. And she bought cigarettes, stuck them in her waistband, wheeled back around. And as she was coming back in, I'm standing there with my arms crossed. So we need to return those cigarettes. I'm like, and if my first thought is, great birthday present. Way to go, Mom. You know, but I understood. It wasn't about hurting me, about meeting her need. And so, but what's been cool is she has really softened. She was very, you know, I can imagine she's been a widow forever in a quiet home. And then she moves into our chaotic house with five kids and stuff. And I won't let her smoke and drink. And, you know, well, she does get to drink a little bit because how do you put an 80-year-old or 85-year-old at that time through a detox program, you know, but that keeps her in check. Anyway, she's softened. She's really softened. You can just feel it in her now and see it. What she says now before she goes to bed every night. Good night. I love you. Thanks for everything. Those words never would have come out of my mom's mouth 7 years ago. It just wouldn't have, you know. And so we've seen her heart be softened. And my daughter's boyfriend, back when we were in Texas, he said, well, Sister Young, she's living in a home where the spirit is. That she doesn't know what that is. And I'm like, yeah, I remember. I represent that. But you feel it and it's calming and it's peaceful. And so she's so darn funny. She loves to tell when she's very impatient. And when the doctor comes in, she's like, come on, I have a pole dancing practice, Nick, in 30 minutes. Hurry up. You know, she says the funniest things. She gets all kinds of free things because she says funny things and the doctors love it. And, you know, it's just so fun. It's really good. So I could tell you millions of stories about how dang funny she is. But she also taught me how to be a good mom, right? But I had to ponder on it and glean it in. Because again, I really believe every hard thing that happens to us is for our best self. But I could have just been pissed off at her.
Yeah.
And by looking at the things and making connections, as I understood how father still loved me and still loved my son, you know, so it's hard lessons, but so worth it. Really worth it.
So how do you meet Saint Bob?
Well, just like I don't remember our car accident, I don't remember the first time I met him, but he does, because he was a stinker. I caught that one. For those of you listening, I still worry that sometimes bad words will come out of my mouth, even though that's not who I normally am. Right now, sometimes those are there and that's okay, but I try not to let them come out. So anyway, we were in California. After my mission, I wanted to get to know my half brother better and had the opportunity to take a job in San Diego near y'all. Well, one of you, and then got headhunted up to LA to work for Rockwell. And that's up in the LA area. I met my husband. So we both went to a young adult dance. He was in Long Beach and I lived right near LAX. My roommate and I were there. A wonderful time. This is the story he tells me because I don't remember it. He came in, he saw me and I was like, whoa. It was like this light. And he's like, I know that girl. He was stalking me, essentially walking around, looking at me, trying to figure out how do I know her? And then he realized, I don't know her, but I guess I need to meet her. So he asked me to dance. And as we're dancing, he looks at me. And I want you to know, I'm a very young looking person, but I am 3 years older than him. So that made me 28 and him 25. But he could tell I was older than him. So before he bothers to introduce himself, he decides, nah, she's too old. So after we get, yeah, right? Right? And then
his this mom is before later, sainthood, I imagine.
Yes, yeah, way before. So after the dance song, he walks away. So I never met him. So I do not remember meeting him. I don't remember the first time we met. But about 6 months later, we're at a dance in my neck of the woods. And by the way, that was the one and only time he ever went out to Glendale, which was way out of their area, but they just wanted to go to a dance. So the next time, 6 months later, we were at a dance in near the LAX area, and it was a Hula Hawkins dance. So you dressed Hawaiian, but it was girl ass guy. So he and all his buddies are there, and my roommate and I are there, and he sees me again. He's like, oh my gosh, there's that girl again. And I'm come over after this last song, I'm dancing with someone, and I go over walking straight for him to ask the next guy to dance and ask the guy next to him. And I purposely asked that guy next to him because he looked younger and safe, because I was a little nervous about asking someone, you know. And so I'm dancing with his friend Kenny, who ended up being our DJ for our wedding, and while I'm dancing, Bob's like, okay, I'm just gonna have to ask, you know, I gotta figure out a way to meet her. Well, the next song or sometime that night, I'm dancing with one of my friends that was in my stake, Dale, and when we're dancing, Bob can tell that we know each other. We're having a conversation different than like when like, hi, what's your name kind of thing. So after that song, he says, Dale, do you know that girl? He says, yeah, that's Beth. It's like, I got to meet her. He says, no problem. I can introduce you. So the dance is over. It's ended. The lights are up. And just before that happens, a friend that Bob knew before his mission, who had not been a Latter-day Saint, who now was a Latter-day Saint, he runs into her. And so they're chatting. And he claims that there was only one chair. So she sat on his lap so that they could have a conversation.
So he was a saint. He was a saint after all.
Right? I know, right? I've heard of lap dances, but lap chats.
Right? So anyway, he's chatting with her, and Dale, who was a great guy, but he was a little bit socially inept. My roommate and I are walking to leave the dance. So he yells across the dance floor, hey, Beth, I have someone I want you to meet. And immediately Bob goes into panic thinking, I got to meet this girl, but I have a girl on my lap. What do I do? So he thinks, I'll just stand up and gently set her down. In his haste, he stands up and she goes flying, flying. And he doesn't even help her up. He just looks at her and says, sorry, and goes walking over to me. Isn't that terrible?
That's right. Hilarious.
So the first thing he says, hi, my name is Bob. And the first thing I say is, do you treat all your women that way? Great, right? And so, but immediately he's like, great, this woman has a sense of humor. So that's how we met. And he got my number from Dale after we chatted and we left. And so he called me the next night. But it was the night of, it was Sunday night, and I was at church with the fireside for the youth because I was in Young Women. So no one answered. And then he got to thinking. So he leaves a message because he is really funny. So he leaves a message. Hey, Beth, I was just calling to see if you wanted to go out to dinner, but I guess you're not home. So just give me a call when you get back and we can arrange a time. And he hangs up, doesn't say his name, doesn't give me a phone number. So I'm listening to this. I'm like, dude, you forgot your name and phone number. So now he's got this great idea. This could be really fun. So the next day he knows I work. So he calls it like 11 in the day because he's a college student. So he can do that, purposely not getting me in. He's like, so Beth, it's me again. I'm really worried you're not calling me back. Do you not want to go out with me? Please give me a call tonight. Okay. And again, so now every time I'm yelling at the answering machine, you didn't leave me. So he does it one more time. So now I'm ready to like shoot him when I find him. Then the next night when he calls, I'm at Mutual with my youth, but my roommate answers. Hello, is Beth there? No. I'll call back later. And she's like, is this the guy who's been calling the last few days? Yes. Oh, why did you leave your number? She couldn't do it. I mean, she just tore into him. And about that time I came in, and we were able to set the date, and it just went from there. And it's been wonderful. It's been wonderful. So, he's so fun. But he made the mistake. He would tell, he told his mom that I was older than him. So she called me grandma as a joke, not to me, but in front of him. So the first time I get to meet her, he tells me, I'm not going to introduce you unless you, he says, you've got to introduce yourself as grandma. I said, I am not going to say that to your mom. The first time I meet your mom, I'm not going to do that to her. He's like, that's what I'm going to do. So he was in a play at church. And so I'm there. And afterwards we all get together and I'm standing there with my roommate and his mom and him. And I'm like looking at him like, come on, introduce. And he won't. And I'm telling you, we stand there at least like 3 or 4 minutes. So finally I put my hand out and say, hi, I'm grandma. And she gave, you know, that look those mothers give when they're really ticked off at their kid that could kill them.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
He got that look. He got it. So that's just hilarious. A fun guy. Good guy. You know, really awesome. Good man.
So yeah. For our younger audience, there was a time before caller ID.
Yes. Right. Yeah. In the olden days.
Predicament that we would often be in when you didn't have somebody's caller ID flash on your phone.
Right. Yeah. And back then you couldn't get a message unless you had an answering machine plugged into your phone. So yeah. Back in the horse and buggy days when I was growing up.
So Beth, right. let's talk about a rich moment, right? So you've introduced us to a lot of folks in your life, and you have Bob and you have your kids and they're grown now, and you've got your mom and you got memories of dad. Can you paint me a picture of a time, a memory of a moment in which you truly felt rich? Somewhere along that journey.
Well, there's a lot of rich times. Every time one of my children was born healthy, that's a huge rich moment, you know, because there's many that are not so blessed. And it's, I don't want to say blessing because that implies that they don't get a blessing, but that was a gift and I'm grateful for that. The one that popped in my head as you were asking is actually an interesting story, but it taught me the importance of having tenacity, because father will work things out. So one of my heroes is Fred Rogers from Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And he said so many brilliant things, but one of the things he taught, and I'm going to have to look at it because I can't always remember well, and I wrote it down so I wouldn't mess it up. So he believed that it's our role to provide the soil and then rely on the Holy Ghost to turn it into holy ground. Hmm. So we need to do our part to be inspired and do it, but then just let the Spirit do whatever it does. Because he found that people would write letters to him, Mr. Rogers did, and they'd say, gosh, in this show, you said this and this, and this is how it helped me overcome whatever it was. He's like, that wasn't in the script, but it's something sort of near it was, but the Spirit helped him. So one of my responsibilities back in Texas, I was over public affairs. I was a coordinating council director, public affairs. What a mouthful, right? I was a regular stake one first and then a big one. And so when I was first the stake one in my community in Friendswood, Texas, they had a monthly prayer breakfast, and it was run by a very conservative, maybe like an evangelical guy. It had been started by his father-in-law, but all the ministers came, all the community came, the mayor came, you know, just different cities officials. And they had just started the program Just Serve. And so I was excited to go because I knew that there would be people there that were looking for ways to let people know they needed service. And at that time, Latter-day Saint missionaries needed 10 hours of service a week. And when they did that, they were specifically directed, you don't talk religion, you're just there to serve. So I knew that would be a safe place to do it. So being the person I am, when I got there, I said, who's running the show? Because I got there early. Byron. Okay, Byron. My husband calls him a modern day Cora whore. Anyway, I go to Byron, I introduce himself, shake hands with him and explain, I'm Beth Young. I'm with the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And I'm here because I want to pray with y'all like the rest of the community. But I also have a resource that might be helpful where if you have people that are needing volunteers, there's a website that I am administering that they can get volunteers to help them. So I'd like to announce that because I see that you have on your agenda here that there's a spot for announcements. How do I go about getting on that agenda? And he stopped for a minute. He says, well, I'm afraid I can't let you do that. I'm like, okay, maybe next month? No, I can't let you speak at all. I said, well, why not? He says, well, I know about Latter-day Saints, and you don't believe in Jesus the way I believe in Jesus. And I would be remiss in my duty if I allowed you to speak and guide people away. I said, I'm not wanting to talk religion. I'm just wanting to let people know here's a volunteer resource for you. Can't let you do it. So then I shared, and then he went on bashing the Latter-day Saint Church. And so I just said, hey, I just want you to know that when I became a Latter-day Saint, it was the first time in my life I actually felt God's love and the depth of what my Savior had done for me. And he is my Savior. And without him, you know, the whole thing. And he's like, that's nice. So I went down, sat with eight other people at my table. And it was really cool because I came from a Protestant background. And so at the end of it, they asked, you know, who needs prayers? And then at your table, you go around and take turns praying out loud for the people that need prayers. And so I was able to tell the people at my table about Just Serve. but I went faithfully every month and learned and would tell more people at the tables, got to know some of the local leaders, got to know the Baptist minister, the Catholic priest. I mean, got to know people that were very, very wonderful. About a year into this, I get a call from Byron's assistant. She said, because they would have a little service moment or some neat little moment, and then they'd have their speaker. And she's like, hey, when you RSVP'd for the breakfast, I saw that you had a Just Serve thing and I clicked on it. So that ministry that you're doing, Just Serve, I talked to Byron and we want you to talk about that before the meeting. I'm like, you told Byron it was Beth Young? He says, yeah, yeah. Okay. So I get everything ready, have all my little cards with Just Serve. I have a video. I get there extra early because they would move to different churches for the presentation. So I reached out to that church and their tech guy was there anyway, got all this stuff primed and ready, got to meet the minister, really nice man, said, thanks for letting us be at your church. He's like, says, I'm really excited to hear about Just Serve. I have lots of people in my congregation wanting to serve. I can't wait to hear it. Great. And then Byron gets there about 10 minutes before it's going to start. And his assistant comes up to him and says, I want to introduce you to Beth. And he walks over and his face went and he walked away. He says, Susan, come here. I need to talk to you. So they go out of the room and he ultimately decides she's not presenting, you know? So he comes back and he says, Beth, I am really sorry. He says, I blew it. When my assistant sent me the information, I looked at it, but I didn't look at it close enough to realize that it was associated with your church. I said, it's not, it's a nonprofit. You know, I says, I'm not going to talk about the letters. He says, well, I just can't let you present. I'm like, okay. He says, you need to go collect up all those cards and everything. He says, okay. So I gathered all that stuff up. And of course I'm fuming, but I'm thinking something good is going to come from this. And what's interesting is our ladies every year would get together and make quilts for the traveling angels that would go pick up people at the airport that were going to go get chemo treatment. So they'd have a homemade quilt to keep them warm, but we had extras. And so I felt prompted to bring two of those to this meeting. Didn't know why. So we have the meeting. When it's over, the minister of that church, who I'd chatted with before, but not since I got booted out of the agenda, says the closing prayer. And as he's praying, I feel very clearly, go talk to Todd. He knows who needs those two blankets. So I'm like, okay. Get all done. So I go over to him. I says, hey, Todd, first, I want to apologize. I hope that it wasn't awkward with you with what happened with Byron and stuff. He's like, Beth, I'm so sorry. He runs this. I said, I don't fault you at all. I totally understand. I'm sorry I put you in a bad situation. He says, well, thank you. I says, but I have a question for you. I said, I felt so strongly to bring these two blankets that had been handmade by our women's service organization. And when you're giving the closing prayer, I feel like you are the one that knew who needs them. He's like, yes. There's a family in our ward that is adopting twin babies and I'm visiting them today. Could I give those to them? I said, I would love for you to. They need them. It's for them. And Byron never knew about it. No one ever knew about it. Todd and I knew about it, but that's why I was supposed to be there. But what was interesting is I still continued to go every month, except for like 2 months when I had a broken knee. And finally, 8 months later, I always would go over to Byron. Hi, Byron. How are you doing? He didn't know my name. That's how it slipped in that I got in because he didn't know my name. He didn't bother to learn my name. He knew my name now. And he said, you know, Beth, I'll hand it to you. You have tenacity. And I said, Byron, I just love the Lord. And I love praying for my community. And so do other Latter-day Saints. So I'm going to keep coming here as long as I live here, you know. And that was a key moment in me realizing that we can be friends with people that don't like us and the Lord still can use us. And those relationships I built helped during Hurricane Harvey, because they had created an emergency disaster religious group, and myself and the Baptist minister were the heads, because no one else would volunteer to be the heads. And so during Hurricane Harvey, we were able to organize getting helping hands. The LDS church ran an emergency call center and getting the work crews out. The Baptist church took all the donations, because tons of people wanted to donate for the hygiene kits and water and general things. And then the Catholic church took all the food for the food donations. And all that came from being in that community prayer breakfast. So
that's awesome.
When you have a responsibility or an assignment, make it your own, own it, you know, and get a testimony of it. And then you have these really great experiences that are pivotal in how you serve later. It made me realize I need to really be committed to my callings, because look at the good it does.
Yeah.
Well, Beth, but we are coming up on 2 hours, just like this, right?
Crazy.
Just like this. But I mean, before we do wrap things up, you mentioned five pillars of healthy living. Can you talk to us a little bit about what that work is?
Sure. I'm really grateful for my parents' lifestyle, because it made me realize I didn't want that one. I wanted a healthy lifestyle. And that has become my mantra. I got a degree in criminal justice, put myself through college arresting shoplifters, worked in white collar crime, and then corporate legal stuff.
And, there's so much there. There's
a whole other story there,
oh, right? Like criminal justice.
Hear how I scared the crap out of someone once, but we're not going to go there tonight. but it's all a journey, right? And it got me to where I finally realized Heavenly Father gave me this opportunity to help people be healthy because of who I am. And so I created my company about 10 years ago. It's Five Pillars of Health: what we eat and drink, movement, the kind word for exercise, relationships, which, yes, those are important to be healthy, quality sleep, and stress management. But all of those are really affected by the stress management. So that's why I became a certified Tai Chi instructor, because if you're stressed, you eat crappy, your relationships suck, you can't sleep, and you don't exercise, right? So I felt like I couldn't become an expert in all of those, but I know a lot about all those things. But I surround myself with experts that once I have people needing to go to the next step, I have people I can refer them to. But I love giving keynotes. So I'll give a five-pillar presentation on, here's some really easy, one simple change at a time. Here's 10 tips. And I walk them through 10 things they can do to eat and drink more healthy, and then invite them to choose one. A small one. Don't start with quit smoking. You know, start with, instead of drinking 12 soda pops today, I'm going to drink 10, drink an extra glass of water, you know.
That's my style.
Yeah.
You don't want me to get started on soda pop. Man, that is so bad for you.
But one simple change at a time, right?
Absolutely. But just so you know, Mike, for every soda you drink, you need to drink 7 glasses of water to get all the crap out that you've put in, because it's leaching calcium out of your bones. It's so bad for you. People that drink more than a cup of soda a day die 3 years earlier than they would have, whether it's sugared or unsugared. So work yourself down. Just work yourself down. Yeah. I've got all kinds of goodies like that. So those are the five pillars. And I do keynotes where I will speak. I've spoken at youth conferences and other things. I really focus in. The way I've focused the last couple of years since I've been in Utah is that there's over 500 medical studies on the benefits of doing Tai Chi regularly. That's like 24 minutes a day regular. But literally, if you do not already have dementia, it will prevent dementia. If you have other health illnesses, it will improve them. It's amazing for anxiety and depression. I had one student that anytime she's a young adult, if she was going to go somewhere, she had such anxiety, she'd fall into a cry fest, and then she could go to the activity. After just 4 weeks of Tai Chi, she could go to activities without crying. I mean, that's huge. And that's quick, because normally it takes about 12 weeks to get that kind of results. So I'm focused more on the anxiety and depression now, because that helps with addiction recovery. They've got great results. People, when they did it with addicts in recovery, they stayed in recovery 62% more of the time, versus normally it's like 25 to 33%. So it really helps your recovery, because most of us, when we're depressed or anxious, we medicate some way, right? I go do Tai Chi. I go for a walk. I play pickleball, you know, but not everyone does that. And so that's my focus has been more on that and suicide, because we didn't all the way get into this, but I have the one gay son. I have a daughter who's bisexual. I have another daughter who's a lesbian that is romantically attracted to her husband, but is not sexually attracted to him. So I have two straight sons and then three somewhere in the LGBTQ world. And so I have a lot of study and compassion and understanding of what that includes. And it often includes suicide. Mm-hmm. So I really, those are my wheelhouses now, really focusing on suicide, anxiety, depression, addiction, recovery. Now we're going to talk a little bit more about trauma because my wheelhouse helps with that too. So that's what my five pillars are. I have a website. It's called refuelingyourlife.com. And that's where if you were going to take a class with me or hire me to speak to your corporate group or as, you know, the humorous but healthy person in between the boring guys talking about engineering, you know, at a event, that's me, you know. So that's what I do.
You also mentioned North Star. Can you talk briefly about that work?
Yes. North Star is, I know they have like little groups throughout the country, I believe, but it's actually stationed here in Utah. And they are for people who are the LGBT community, who are LGBTQ, or their family members that want to keep their covenants, stay in their conservative Christian beliefs and lives, and not act on those feelings. And so they have a conference once a year that is fabulous. And they also have firesides and other things to help be a support there. And so before I lived here, a friend of mine had told me about North Star. And when Andy had come out to us, he was on his mission. I went to my North Star conference and like, okay, I got to come here all the time. And then we moved here. And so I've been able to go several years in a row. Then with COVID, you know, we didn't get to do it last year, but it's going to be again this June. Okay. So it's a great, great, well-run organization. And I'll tell you, I love the love that's there. You just feel the depth of love. And you know, 1 year I decided I don't really understand trans folks, so I need to understand that better. So at lunch, I sat at the table where all the trans people were sitting. And I said, okay, my son's gay, but I want to understand and be sensitive to how I talk because I know I say things wrong. You know, I don't have the pronouns right. And I'm trying to learn that. And I was sitting next to a woman who presented herself as a woman, but was biologically a man. And she was wonderful because I kept saying the wrong he, she, it thing. And she just kept saying, Beth, she, I said, oh, sorry, no problem. I appreciate that you care and you want to try, you know? So I think, and that's a real tricky, interesting, what do we do with all that kind of thing? And I think as Christians, we owe it to our brothers and sisters to understand that in compassion and try and figure out, okay, it's not my place to judge or decide what that means. It's my place to just love. And in my opinion, we're not being a good Christian if we're not trying to figure that out. You know, we just aren't. We need to.
Yeah, that's the song, right? By this shall men know you are my disciples if you have love one to another. And when we don't, we are sending the message that we are not.
Yeah.
We're not disciples of Jesus Christ. And I think that when we struggle with these things that are difficult to understand, I think that a place for empathy is to help ask questions.
Yes.
Ask questions and have experiences where you can interact with folks and ask those questions and try to seek to, like you said, listen to understand. And I think that is part of this, you know, and I think that that's where that love will come in as you realize that these are our brothers and our sisters and they're struggling.
And it takes baby steps, I think, in understanding, and I know that I was Stake Relief Society president when I was learning all this stuff and I wanted to get a support group for the LGBT community and our stake and all these other things. And our stake president, President Schmidt, he's like, Beth, I agree, but we need to stay in step with the brethren. And I folded my arms and huffed and puffed. But then I realized, you know, I may be ready to understand this, but there's other people in our church and other churches that aren't ready to understand. So if we go in too hard and too heavy, it's going to do more harm than good. You know, and so we need to do our learning and look for opportunities, but also realize that the steps need inspiration and progression appropriately, you know?
Yeah, I think of Vi Sikahima's conference address regarding sequencing.
Right.
And I think that's a powerful thought. And, you know, he doesn't necessarily bring up this topic, but we believe in a God of order. And I think that sequencing is important to, especially when we're trying to understand complex things. So, Beth, honestly, I feel like we scratched the surface.
You didn't even hear about my book, but that's a whole nother hour.
I'm thinking you got to come back.
Yeah, that's
right. I'm thinking so too.
Thinking you got to come back because I mean, there's a book out there. I mean, you mentioned Brain Tumor.
Oh yeah, that one slipped out, didn't it?
Yeah, and then I'm dying to know how you get into criminal justice, and then you get.
Can we find that? I've got a gnarly scar up here from the brain tumor. They cut me from ear to ear.
Oh my goodness.
And my boys thought it was so cool because I had 52 staples in my head and the doctor, nice and even, it looked like a zipper.
Wow.
And my daughters are like, mommy, because they were only five, mommy, cover it up.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And an interesting thing is from that brain tumor, we learned after my accident that the reason I got the brain bleed is because of some other things related to that tumor, which I'm not going to go into here, but interesting. So,
but operable, and here you are.
It was non-cancerous. We named it Willie because it was on the, I can't remember the name of it. Sometimes the brain just doesn't cooperate. Anyway, there's a circulatory system and there's a certain vein in there that's called the Willis something or other. So we named it Willie. Then Willie's got to go.
So much more to talk about, but Beth, we always when we get to this part, we have loved our time with you tonight, and this whole project is about trying to get better, and I really want to live that rich, full life, and you've given us a little glimpse of what that looks like, but we think of George Bailey, you know, and Christmas is behind us a little bit in the rearview mirror, but George is always with me. I'm always thinking about the lessons from that movie and the lessons from that simple but rich life. And we've patterned this after that search for the rich life. So,
so inspired.
At the end of the movie, he's toasted by his little brother as the richest man in town. So to you, Beth, what does it mean to be considered the richest woman in town?
I think to have loving relationships intact. Our family and our friends, they know without a doubt that they are safe with me. And that's so important to me that they know that. My friends know that if they say it has to be in the vault, that it's in the vault and that I'm there for them and that I'm not going to judge them. I might not agree with them, but I'm not going to judge them. And so I think to be rich for me is to have loving, trusting relationships so that when I'm gone, they can say, I can trust her. I can love her. I'm a different person because she was in my life, you know? And I think it's important to let people know that. A friend of mine who, I know his name, but not, now, I knew it 2 months ago. He's written a book called Reset, but he's also written a book called Talents. And hopefully his name will come to me, or we can put it in the show notes. Mm-hmm. Anyway, his book on talents is awesome because it talks about sending an email to your friends and family that know you well and say, hey, what are talents I have? We need to know what our talents are so that we can magnify them. And my inspired husband, when I turned 60, reached out to my friends from high school and from, you know, work a million years ago and back in Texas and everything. And he made a book of 60 years of charity with Beth. And it was just love notes from all those.
Wow.
And that was very touching and it meant a lot to me. But when I was in the really dark moments, like Christmas Eve, I couldn't go to sleep until 4 a.m. and I was like hating everything and everyone. And New Year's Eve, again, it happened. I turned to that book and started reading it. And it gave me hope because I thought that Beth is still there. She did not die in that car. And so it's important to, the best thing we can do is tell some parent how amazing their child is. Sincere words, right? Not just after they, you know, shot your neighbor, but sincerely, look for opportunities to catch people doing good, you know, like from the 1 Minute Manager, that book, you know, but share it with parents and with people. I always try and think of when people do something good, I want to acknowledge it and recognize it, because we need that. We all need to know that we're on the right track. So relationships.
I love that answer, Beth. I love the idea of loving relationships intact. Interestingly enough, we are here tonight because of a relationship that you had with one of our previous guests. And so we love that
the dingle butts.
The dingle butts, right? That's absolutely right. So I love that answer. And you know what? It's been a pleasure to spend some time with you and get to know you a little bit. I do hope that you'll agree to come back with us and spend some more time. There's a lot of things that we could learn from you. And I'm there's some stories there that we didn't even touch on that I think deserve to be dug into, Mike.
Well, I'm just appreciative and so very grateful that you're still with us. Honestly, that November accident, that's a scary thing.
Very much.
You know, it could have been very different. Yeah.
Yeah. And what I've learned from the couple of hours that we spent is just reminded of the richness of life and how precious it is, right? And how precious the people are and the relationships that we have and the experiences and the hinge moments and good moms and good dads and right. Like all of it. And it's messy. It's a messy thing. And like you said, it's a roller coaster and all of these things, but in the end, man, isn't it wonderful?
Yeah.
Right. Isn't it wonderful in all of it, and how grateful we should be to our Heavenly Father for letting us have this ride. I'm grateful, Beth, for you riding with us for a couple tonight.
It was fun. You guys are awesome. I love getting to know you better. I got to come out to Southern Cal, or we have to meet somewhere halfway in between.
Well, we got to figure that out. Absolutely. Yeah.
Our people are going to get with your people, and we're going to make this happen again. Okay.
That's right.
We want to go to Alcatraz and do the night tour, because we've done the day one. So maybe we could all meet in San Francisco.
Oh, let's do that.
Wouldn't that be fun?
I don't know about night Alcatraz.
Oh, come on. Don't be a chicken. I'll protect you. I know Tai Chi.
That's right. Well, we love it, Beth. We appreciate you. We love you, and we're grateful for you.
Good idea, Ernie. A toast to my big brother, George, the richest man in town.